Welcome to First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis, the birthplace of Congregational Humanism. We carry on that tradition of free thought today, dedicated to promoting a free search for truth, meaning, and justice. Our web address is firstunitarian.org. I'm David Breeden, Senior Minister. Welcome.
Watching this video. For those of you in the building, please join others downstairs in the lower assembly hall for our mini meal. Today we have very veggie egg bake and a serious salad bar. At 12:15 today, we'll have the talk of the talk, 12:15 in the Dietrich with Reverend David today. Just for your information, in the building, there's no religious education programming today. We do have childcare, and young ones are welcome to stay in the assembly. I want to issue congrats to the winners of the chili cook-off yesterday. First place to Lisa Green, second place to Barb Watts, third place to Bob Jandro. It was a gorgeous, and I hear, delicious day at FUS, and thanks to all who made it special, including all the cooks, musicians, and MC Sandy Sample. A good time was reportedly had by all. We hope that you'll wear your masks in the upper assembly hall at FUS. The rest of the building is masked optional, but as you're sitting there next to each other, please wear your masks, but the choir will not be in your singing. Our theme this month is courage. And tomorrow marks the founding of the United Nations in 1945. Here are the words of Hubert Humphrey. The heroes of the world community are not those who withdraw when difficulties ensue, not those who can envision neither the prospect of success nor the consequence of failure, but those who stand in the heat of battle, the fight for world peace through the United Nations. Come, let us gather in community.
Good morning. So I gotta tell y'all something. I've had a very sore throat, been a little bit sick. I work around children, so there it is. But to help me out today, I was wondering if you guys might be willing to sing a little bit with me?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I love how enthusiastic you guys are. This is so cool. So if you know the song, please sing it with me, so I won't feel so alone up here. Thank you. Forever
and ever, we never will part. Oh, how I love you. Together, together, that's how it must be. To live without you would only mean heartbreak for me. Thank you guys for singing.
I'm going to have to get a sore throat so I can sing like that again, if that's what does it. Each week when we gather, we repeat one of our principles of Unitarian Universalism, or one of our aspirations. Today, the second aspiration of First Unitarian Society, we aspire to make the change we need for a more just, compassionate, and peaceful world.
Before I put this mic away, I just wanted to thank Charmaine Douglas again for being here. Charmaine is actually a recent high school graduate. She went to the St. Paul Conservatory for Performing Artists, where I worked with her for a couple years, and has always been this good. You've always been this good. Incredible. Such a talent. And I'm really happy to have her with us. She's got a band in town called The Culture that's starting to gig out. That's really wonderful. So if you ever see The Culture listed, go check it out. They are phenomenal. It's like a 9-piece band, several singers, a bunch of musicians, excellent stuff. So aside from that, today we're going to have the Chalice Choirs here with us today. We're going to be doing a couple pieces, one called Closer to the Flame, which is sticking kind of with our October theme of courage, about pushing onward towards a flame, even though we don't know what it's going to be or what to expect, but just moving towards the future, full tilt. And then at the end, we'll do another piece called Greater Than. That's going to have Charmaine's going to join us for that one more time. Here on, you'll see the word listed for what is in the songbook as 168, One More Step. We're going to be doing as One More Song today. We are doing some updated text to reflect our desire to be more inclusive for ableism. So please look at the text on the screen, as it will not be the same as what's in your songbook.
So let's sing together and rise as we're willing.
Congregational covenant. Love is the spirit of this place, and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Please be seated.
Good morning. I am Mark Johnson, and I am here in my role as president of the FUS Foundation. One of the really fun parts of the work of the foundation is to give away money to support worthy organizations in the community. Today I'm here to talk a little bit about our grants to the community from the Kurt Pearson Memorial Fund. The fund was established in 1992 in memory of Kurt by his parents. Each year, the fund makes grants to nonprofit organizations that Kurt would have found important. This year, the fund is making grants to four worthy groups, and I just wanted to outline their work briefly for you. The first is Walk-In Counseling Center, whose mission is to provide free, anonymous, easily accessible mental health counseling to people who have urgent needs and few service options. Excuse me. The second is to the Pacifica Institute, who provide emergency relief for the people of Alamos in Sonora, Mexico. The support is provided in a number of ways, including emergency food and clothing distribution and direct services to victims of domestic and sexual violence. We are also providing support for MORE. MORE is a nonprofit that works to assist new Americans in obtaining financial security through employment, access to financial resources, and support of their overall well-being. And the fourth nonprofit is Gender Justice. Gender Justice works to advance gender equality under the law. Gender Justice envisions a world where everyone can thrive regardless of their gender, gender expression, or sexual orientation. These are wonderful organizations, and as in the past, you will hear more from them on following Sundays, either in person or by video. But we just wanted to announce these grants today so that you'd know what was going on, but also to take a moment and reflect on the legacy that Kurt Pearson has created for us. Thank you so much, and look forward to hearing from these nonprofits as we move forward.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. It's great to hear about the legacy and our ongoing work for our causes. First Unitarian Society exists because of the generosity of our members and friends in time, in talent, and in treasure. This congregation is independently funded and democratically governed. One way you can help is on social media. That's free. Whatever you're on, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, etc., like, love, forward, whatever they happen to do on that particular medium so that we can get our message out there. If you are watching on YouTube, definitely like it. None of what we do is cost-free. We need your help at First Unitarian Society to keep us going and healthy. The easiest way to give is to go to our website, firstunitarian.org, click on the Give button at the upper right corner. You can also go to PayPal, the Vanco mobile app, or you can send or drop off a check in the office. For those of you who are in the building, we will have a machine downstairs and we'll help you to donate at a pay point downstairs after assembly today. And thank you all so much for all you do for First Unitarian Society. Yes, you missed it this year, but Retreat to the Woods happens every year, and thanks so much to our committee and to everyone who was involved with this year's highly successful Retreat to the Woods. First Unitarian Society is a congregational humanist community. Yes, we freely search for knowledge and meaning, and we work for justice. We are also here for each other. So it is, on Sundays, as a gathered community, we take a few moments to reflect on the joys and the sorrows and the milestones of the human experience. In doing this, we remind ourselves of the value of a moment of stillness, and we are reminded to stay in touch with our own humanity. We are here for each other. A joy. Jeff and Ann Langard welcomed their first grandchild, Maxine Mary Langard, on Wednesday. Yes, you will be seeing Anne here. Now, if my count is correct, this is fourth generation FUS here we're talking about. Not bad at all, and quite a family tradition. Congratulations to Jeff and Anne. A reminder that next Saturday, October 29th at 2 p.m., we will celebrate the life of longtime FUS member Larry Salzman here in the Upper Assembly Hall. That also will be available on live stream, and we will have a reception afterward downstairs. Now we will take a few moments to reflect on our world and those who work to comfort and heal the suffering and those who work for justice.
When I breathe in, I'll breathe in peace. when I breathe out, I'll breathe out love. When I breathe in, I'll breathe in peace. When I breathe out, I'll breathe out love.
Thank you all so much. You know, Anne, I was thinking, great grandparents,
She's never going to meet her great-grandparents, but all you have to do is bring her to the building and say, hey, they helped build this place, right? So Arnold and Helen will be remembered for a long time. And that's one of the beauties of an institution, I think. They go on. They go on. Sunday before last, I took a shot at defining what we mean by the concept of liberalism. The term liberal gets thrown around a lot. It's the opposite of conservative. So, except, you know, what's that? Well, I want to really think a little bit today about what all of that means. And 2 weeks ago, I shared excerpts from an article reporting on NatCon, a Christian nationalist conference. By looking at their agenda, which in lots of instances is diametrically opposed to the values that most of the folks here share, I think we can see a little bit more graphically what liberalism means to us. The NatCon agenda includes things such as a near total moratorium on immigration. Well, I guess we just heard that one of the Pearson grants is going for new Americans, so I guess we don't really agree with that, huh? Right? Christian nationalism to dominate the public square. Well, I'm going to talk more about that. A rollback of LGBTQ rights. Well, yeah, that's diametrically opposed to one of our Pearson grants this year. Economic nationalism and opposition to globalist supranational institutions, such as the UN. Yeah, I don't think we agree with that. A vendetta against woke elites in cultural, academic, economic, and governmental institutions, and using state power to achieve conservative ends. My point two Sundays ago was that if any of this affronts you, you're probably a liberal, right? After all, concretely seeing what we are not, I think, helps us see what we are. Is liberalism as a concept opposed to a near total moratorium on immigration? Yep, it sure is. Is liberalism as a concept opposed to Christian nationalism to dominate the public square? Yep, I think so. Is liberalism as a concept opposed to a rollback of LGBTQ rights? Yes, we are. So, a more positive definition, is liberalism as a concept synonymous then with democracy? And I think it is. Is liberalism synonymous with an embrace of multiple viewpoints and multiculturalism? I think it is. Is liberalism synonymous with the non-interference of specific religions in government? Yep. Yet, look around us. Those points by our opponents are gaining adherence all over the planet. The recent election in Italy, the recent election in France that just barely preserved democracy there, the rise of popular and populist national parties all over Central and Western Europe, the turmoil among the conservatives in the UK, not to mention our own midterm elections. Liberalism is on the ropes all over the world. To me, our situation in our time appears to be a crisis concerning central and absolute questions. And the most central and absolute, perhaps, are where does authority lie? Who or what is in charge? The so-called conservative side has an answer. And yeah, the so-called liberal side has an answer. But today, I want to argue some old-fashioned back to basics liberalism, and say that that is a third way of going. If we look at our core values and we can stick with those, and I think we can find a way forward. First, let's look right here at First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis. As I say almost every week, FUS is a democratic and self-governing organization. Here we have an answer to those basic questions. Where lies authority and who is in charge? Well, it's you. You may not know, unless you have served on the FUS board, that they have a covenant. That's what's on the screen there. They read that at the beginning of each of our board meetings. In the interest of time, I won't, but I do want to talk a little bit about the liberalism therein. I mean, inviting all voices to express their truth as they experience it. That's a liberal way of thinking. Promoting a trusting, safe, and rewarding environment. That's liberal. Assuming goodwill. Liberal. The FUS Board Covenant is a liberal document through and through. In the case of this institution, we know where the authority lies. We know who is in charge. Now notice, there is no sentence in there saying, listen to the preacher tell you what God wants. And that's about the last thing that's going to be in there, to be very frank with you. There's no room there for snake oil salespersons coming in and reshuffling the deck of authority. There's no room for marked cards. You, the people, are in charge. And someone like me, if I come in here and start saying, squirrel, squirrel, God told you, you're not going to listen. And that's a good thing. You are in charge. The covenant says you are not buying it. Who or what is in charge? You are in charge. Because, you know why? Yes, there are a bunch of yous among us, and then we gather together into a we, and that's what liberalism is. Humanism calls to you, do not give your power away. And liberalism calls us to that conclusion as well. Stick with it, you are in charge. Now, the first practice is always a local practice, and the FUS board is a good start. But how do we get that into the larger culture? How do we practice our liberalism out there? And American philosopher John Dewey, who I think is the prototypical liberal, once said, we only think when we are confronted with a problem. We only think when we're confronted with a problem. Now, as a liberal, I insist that taking the time to feel our way through a problem is not a luxury. It's how we have to do it. And allow me to admit up front that I am by nature a contemplative person. I don't have a choice about that. I always say, I got to think about it. There are people born to be people of action, and there are people born to be people of contemplation. We need both kinds of people out there, but let's face it, liberals tend to process a lot of things in their heads. But John Dewey was onto something when he said, we only think when we're confronted with a problem. Yeah, let me sit with that, not make my day. Dewey lived a long while ago, so I do want to update that little saying a little bit. Problem is kind of a problematic word. Let's be more optimistic. Let's say challenge. We only think when we are confronted with a challenge. For those of you who've studied Dewey's constructivist theory of education, you know that in constructivist education, Montessori is the most famous example of that, but problem solving is the foundation of all education. You're not going to remember it if you didn't solve the problem, argues constructivism. So Dewey saw that the paradigm permitting human social life must be about, wait, there's a problem and challenge. I'm going to fix that. I can think about that. I'm not going to be on autopilot. So science is about problem solving. Art is about problem solving. Philosophy is about problem solving. Politics is about problem solving. International relations is about problem solving. Heck, managing the church budget is about problem solving. The practice of democracy, and in Dewey, democracy is a practice, right? The practice of democracy is about problem solving. The FUS Board Covenant is a document designed to encourage people to problem solve together, not with God talking to me in my study. This deep, deep conviction concerning thinking it through is what makes John Dewey a liberal, and it's what makes this congregation liberal. But let's be real. The conservative side has deep roots in American thought as well. Actually, maybe we could say they have deeper roots, if we're honest, among those European invaders from long ago. We do well to remember that the precursors to the religious liberalism of Unitarians were Pilgrims and Puritans. Puritans came to this continent explicitly to create a Christian theocracy. The theocracy they envisioned was overseen by clergy and enforced by law. In that way, theirs was a vision much like the contemporary Christian nationalists. As it happened, Puritans jailed, beat, exiled, and executed those who dared to disagree with them. And again, if we look closely, the pattern of clergy, like me, in Unitarianism, and indeed in most of Christian tradition, is authoritarian in nature, wielding authority because the clergy claims to know what God wants, or in the case of Puritans and Unitarians, the claim that they can read Scripture better than the rest of you can. Now, that's something to keep your eye on there because, yes, it's authoritarian in nature, and really it hasn't ever changed exactly. As U.S. Thanksgiving approaches, we will be seeing those nice, smiling pilgrims with their funny hats. That's not the story. Puritans were not liberal. They were religious extremists. There is a disturbing through line in American culture from those smiling, white, Anglo-Saxon Protestants to the nostalgia of Make America Great Again. Actually, with a bit of digging, the pilgrims of Thanksgiving take on a sort of demented look if you start looking a little closer at those faces. There's something dangerous baked into the American story, at least in this instance, our conservative friends who insist that the U.S. is a Christian nation are onto something. But I would say that none of it is good, perhaps especially the part that puts clergy in charge of religion and religion in charge of everything else. That's not good. Lest we forget, the Puritans of Boston and their clergy tried and eventually exiled Anne Hutchinson for what they saw as religious heresy. Hutchinson had to leave the colony and she was killed by natives. Lest we forget, Mary Dyer was prosecuted and eventually executed on Boston Common for her Quaker beliefs. As some of you know, I'm going to be talking in Boston in a couple of weeks, a couple times in November, real close to the tree that still survives where they hung Mary long ago. These things don't stop. They go into the DNA. Let's face it, the post-Puritan Congregationalists of Massachusetts got nicer because the multi-religious nature of the United States forced them to be more tolerant. Tolerance was not their choice any more than tolerance is the choice of our Christian nationalist contemporaries. Getting tolerant, let's call it getting nice, is a form of liberalizing, and I think that most liberals would agree that it's nice to be nice, even if that niceness happens to be forced upon you. And we all know that many will be unnice anytime they think they can get away with it. Liberalism is important to our society because we liberals insist in every way possible that it's nice to be nice. It's not a difficult message, but it's difficult to get for many people. The Puritans got nicer because they had to get nice. The Roman Catholic Church got nicer because cruelty wasn't working for them. Again, the central question here is one of authority. Who is in charge? The Puritans in charge did what they wanted to do, and it had to do with murder and beatings and executions. The Roman Catholic Church was in charge, and they did what they wanted to do. Who or what is in charge is always the question, here and in the larger society. Many of our religious friends will say that God is in charge. That God, of course, is the God of their particular interpretation. In European monarchies, the assumption has been that monarchs have civil and social authority because their rule comports with the wishes of church authorities, who are interpreting the will of God. Here, king, do this. Here in the United States, the Puritans operated through covenants that were interpreted by their version of the priests or shamans, those Puritan clergy. They were the authorities. They knew what God wanted. For those of us of a more skeptical bent, we tend to think that the monarchs and their priests and the Puritans and their clergy tend to hear their gods telling them exactly what those in charge of the power structures want to hear. And that's what we liberals expect happens when Christian nationalists are talking. Now, as we all well know, a person does not have to be an atheist to suspect this kind of authority. One can as well simply believe in another sort of God, who isn't saying the same thing as the monarchical priests or the Puritan clergy or the Christian nationalists. There are conservative gods, but there are liberal gods as well. There are conservative Jesuses and liberal Jesuses. And no, the kind of God you believe in or the kinds of gods you're atheistic about are not entirely a private and personal and subjective matter, right? Because your belief goes out into society and that coalesces into groups. Every God and every atheism manifests itself in the actions of individuals, but then those individuals often become voting blocks. I know I'm not telling you anything that you haven't thought about, but I want to underline the fact that the essence of liberalism is about that question: who or what is in charge? Liberals answer, we, the people, are in charge. We are the authority. That is the sacred core of this congregation. What's sacred about First Unitarian Society? We, the people. That's what's sacred. Sure, liberals say, some of us believe in this sort of God, and some of us believe in that sort of God, and some of us believe in no God at all. That's all well and good, we liberals say. It is your liberty to believe as you will. Now, next, let's talk among ourselves and figure out how we, the people, are going to run the congregation and, we hope, the nation. That's the liberal ideal. We sometimes call it secular, but yes, it's a separation of religion and government. Now, there is one big gaping hole in the center of the liberal ideal. Liberalism only works through some sort of democracy, or some kind of republic, if you will. It only works through the will of we the people as revealed by voting. And voting, as we all know, is inherently problematic. Corruption, cheating, those big voting blocks, large groups of people. It's possible for a totally fair election to result in a vote that ensures that another democratic and fair election will never occur again. That is possible. That's the gaping hole in the democratic ideal. And it's one of the greatest fears of liberals. To counteract that very real possibility, citizens write constitutions. We liberals know that there is inevitably and always a hard line right that's going to be screaming, blood and soil, tradition, religion, God. We know that there's inevitably always going to be a hard line left that says, individuality only, let's go, be ourselves. Liberalism does not scream either of those. Rather, we say, where's the middle? Where's the place we can govern from? What is the compromise? Liberals, therefore, often find ourselves betwixt and between a place that, yeah, you can say, oh, those people are milquetoast, half-hearted. Yeah, that's one way of seeing it. It's not, though. Rather, the place between is the place of power. If we might only choose that middle rather than our idealist dreams. That's what John Dewey was talking about when he pointed out that we only do our real thinking when we are thinking about problem solving. No, some things can't be compromised. The worth and dignity of every person is not open for discussion. Furthermore, liberalism as a tradition has recognized that not every disagreement can be settled with a win-win. We know that. If we can't compromise, we take a stand. Still, the place of compromise is not a place of weakness. It's not cowardice. It is the central practice of liberalism. And dare I say, compromise is the only way that democracy can actually work. So the question becomes, do we want to win or do we want to sustain a democratically governed society? The NatCon agenda is not negotiable for liberals. We will not surrender our central values of equity for all, the inherent worth and dignity of all, either as individuals or for groups. But there's something we easily miss when we start talking about extreme agendas. And that easily missed something is an opportunity, because the devil's always in the details, isn't it? And the details and the devil are closely related in Christian nationalism too. At the moment, we're lumping Christian nationalists into one big lump, and they want you to do that too. See them as a very large and developing group. However, in fact, they are not a homogeneous group. Yes, many Christian nationalists go to church, but Christian nationalists are the least likely Christian group to attend church regularly, as a matter of fact. Furthermore, only about 40% of Americans who say they're Christian go to church at all. So actually, these are not huge groups. They look that way, but they aren't. Christian nationalists are more nationalist than they are Christian, in other words. And Christianity itself is becoming more of a cultural marker than a practiced way of life. Divorce? Some of us are old enough to remember when traditionalists said divorce was always bad and always wrong. You know what the most divorced group in America is? Christian nationalists. There are holes in the agenda. Liberalism is indeed on the ropes at the moment, all over the planet. Here, however, we will hold it to our hearts and in our minds, and we will practice liberalism as a congregation. We will practice it also in our larger society, and we will insist upon asking who or what is in charge, and we will continue answering, "We the people."
Let's sing some more, number 170 in the book, also on the screen.
Singing.
Extinguishing the chalice words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. All of these we carry in our hearts and in our minds until we are together again. Thank you.
Go out into the world, be fearless, ask questions, hold on to what is good. Strengthen the weak, comfort the fearful, serve the suffering, do what makes you come alive. Rejoice in the power of the human spirit. So may it be.